Test, test. Test, test, test. Yeah, it seems like it's working.
Yeah,
okay.
It's good.
We're good.
What are you, good? Yes.
You know, get my room.
Turn him off. Turn him off. Okay.
Test.
No.
Test, test, test. This is one, two.
I think it's good, yes.
Good morning. It is good to be here with you all, and I want to welcome you to Covenant First Presbyterian Church. We at this church serve, worship, love, and will speak and pray to the risen and reigning Lord Jesus Christ. We believe here at this church that He orders all things to His will, His purpose, and His glory. And what we want to do is participate with that. We want to be a part of what He is doing. So that is what you have entered into by being here, is a place that worships the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I got the several announcements for you, all of which you'll be able to see in your bulletin. This Thursday coming up is the senior singles outing, if that is something that you qualify for. You are more than welcome to participate in that. I will say, though, dinners for eight at April 28th, this will be a fun thing. Look at the bulletin for more particulars, but I am here to tell you or draw your attention towards that you are to sign up on the form that is in your bulletin, that separate sheet. You could turn that in or sign up on the website if you are interested. This is a fun way for us to get to know one another, so please look into it. Same with Parents Night Out. I draw your attention towards that announcement in the bulletin, as well as the work day that's coming up on May 11th. When you go through these doors at the end of the service and you head towards our fellowship hall, you will receive wonderful treats. I know that there's chocolate back there, but there is also a children's playpen. In that children's playpen, certainly if you had a child, you want to put it in, sure. But it's more than just that. We are collecting items for the St. Mary's Pregnancy Crisis Center. And you'll see what we are collecting. Please, obviously, if this is new information to you, you don't have anything to really donate. But we would invite you to please grab some stuff when you're at the grocery store, stuff that's on this list in your bulletin, and then bring it and put it in the playpen. That is a great way that we can help young women specifically who are newly parents. It's a way for us to help. With that in mind, I invite Tracy Kramer to come forward to lead us in worship.
Good morning. You join me in the call to worship, please. Let us gather, brothers and sisters, with hearts tuned to the Master's call, embarking on the sacred journey of disciple making. We are beckoned to steadfastness in the truth of Scripture, that invaluable guide for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. With the Word as our guide, let us prepare for every good work, standing firm in faith and doctrine. As heralds of the gospel, we are charged to preach the Word, being prepared in season and out of season. In times of challenge, may our voices echo the enduring truth. Our lives exemplify Christ's transformative love, and our actions inspire a legacy of discipleship. Together, let us fulfill our holy calling, equipped by the Spirit to spread the light of Christ's love to all corners of the earth. In this divine appointment, let our worship rise like incense, a testament to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who empowers us for this sacred task.
Thank you.
Will you pray with me? Gracious Father, in your sovereign's grace, guide us to live as disciples of Christ. Strengthen us by your Spirit to embody your word, to nurture faith in others, and to radiate your love. As we gather, unite our hearts in worship and dedication to your mission, so that we may faithfully reflect your light in every word and deed. Amen.
An aspect of the good news is this, that we are able to come and talk to Jesus Christ about our sin. He's so holy and so glorious and magnificent that we couldn't stand under his magnificence. And yet, he condescends to us by becoming man and hearing our prayer. So we are about to confess our sins. We are about to unburden our hearts. We are about to speak to God that which grieved him that we have done. And when we do this, we're going to say the prayer of confession, and there'll be a time of silence where I encourage you, please, unburden your heart. Share with him that which grieves him. Be truthful. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we humbly come before you, acknowledging our shortcomings and the times we have strayed from your path. In our words, thoughts, and actions, we confess that we have not always reflected your love or obeyed your commands. Forgive us for our neglect of your word and our resistance to your Spirit's guidance. We have not lived as your disciples. We have not made disciples. Cleanse our hearts, renew our minds, and restore the joy of your salvation within us. Empower us to live lives that honor you, walking in obedience and grace. In Jesus' name. Let us confess. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, have mercy upon us. We are sinners in need of your healing. It's in your Son's holy name. Amen. Fellow disciples of Jesus, hear this news about our Lord and teacher. He has made you holy enough to receive his holy teaching. He has prepared you through his death, burial, and resurrection to know him and to follow him as your leader. He invites you to follow those who follow him so that you will learn and more fully understand him and his grace. You have all your sins forgiven in him. He loves you and gently restores you. This is the good news. are grateful for our Lord. And we want to make him known. We want to share him. We want to know him. We want what goes on outside these doors to be the overflow of what goes on inside our hearts. We want to participate in his kingdom, to see it come within our midst, to see the world changed for his glory and for our goodness. That's what we do here at Covenant First Presbyterian Church. We participate with what Jesus is up to. We try to seek his will with the strength that only he could provide. We had a retreat yesterday with the session, and the session spent a great amount of time trying to seek the Lord's will, trying to figure out what he is up to next and participate with him to have that trust and ability to do so. When you give to this church, you give to people in need of a Savior, seeking to follow him wherever it is that we go. I encourage you, please give with a joyous heart. Yes, it's time. I would encourage you, when you give, that this is not a sense of obligation. This is not out of necessity for earning your salvation. It is entirely out of the joy that you have for the Lord. Thank you. I got it out of order. I don't know if you've noticed already. We're going to give an offering right now. I'm a little out of sorts myself right now, so please give with a joyous heart. Thank you. We're going to pray a prayer of thanks, and then we'll be seated, and then I'll pray a prayer, the Lord's Prayer, and the pastoral prayer. So let us pray. Lord, thank you for this offering to your glory. We give you thanks, and may we use it to your glory and to serve your kingdom. It is in your Son's holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. Lord, you are an amazing God. You give good gifts. We are beyond measure grateful for the oxygen, food, water, all the way to relationships and friendships. And Lord, we are grateful for everything that you give us. I'm grateful that you've given me Dolly. I'm grateful for her life. Lord, may we live into gratitude. Help us to not live into pain and suffering. Help us to live into you, Lord Jesus. Help us to grow in faithfulness and love and mercy. Help us to seek your face when it is hard to find. Lord, let us always remember that you are with us to the very end of the age, and let us not forget that you will be found in everything that is happening in our lives. You are present. You are active. You are good. Thank you for that, Lord. We are grateful. Lord, we pray for many things. We pray for peace in Israel. We want no more deaths to happen. The new bombing raids that are happening in Israel are scary because it escalates. It creates more reasons for more people to be angry and hate and send more bombs. Lord, we pray for your kingdom to come in the lives of those right outside these doors, inside these doors, but throughout this city. Help us to be people that follow you in what it is that we do. Help us to be faithful to you. Lord, I pray for our politicians. Help them to make the right decisions. And help us go out into our workforce, into the fields where you have called us to labor. May we then will labor to your glory, labor in your name, so that people will see far and wide that you go with us, that you are with us wherever we go. Lord, help us to be faithful. In the Lord's name that we pray, through his prayer we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory forever. Let us stand and sing.
Thank you.
May be seated. It took some detours along the way to get to this point, so thank you for hanging in. We've been in a sermon series about discipleship. Now, I want us to understand that the word disciple and discipleship is a very biblical word. It is a very Old Testament word. It is a word that is used by rabbis. The term would be seen as rabbis that were Pharisees in the New Testament. We're familiar with the Pharisees. Stemmed all the way back to when Moses instituted the elders. There is a connection about what those rabbis saw themselves as leaders in the community to the same thing that Moses instituted, but 1,200 years earlier. So this concept of disciple is the idea of making new, in our case, Christians. Christians that are supposedly new. But I want us to understand that it's not for just the new Christian. The idea of discipleship is also for the Christian who wants to be on the journey of growth. We have a linear way of seeing growth in the Lord. Is that fair? I'm not saying that you believe that that's right, but we think that either you're weak and young, not really a strong Christian, or you're a strong Christian, and there is one linear line along the way. I want us to understand that when we see discipleship, it is not about a linear line. It is about a path that you're being invited on. And this is what I'm hoping that we understand, and I talked about last week in this, is that one of the key elements to start with is repentance, glory, awe, recognizing that He is holy other, and we talk about the fear of the Lord. Well, that's a base for the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord coming from recognizing that He is holy and other, and we are not. That is the beginning of growth in the discipleship realm. You want to be more close to the Father. You want to grow in your relationship with Jesus Christ, the God who said He would be there with you always to the very end of the age. I talked about that last week. Today I talk about something different. We all have a starting point with which we value most. We all do. There's not a single one of us. And some people's starting point is I will never do this. I will never do that. And it's because of maybe your own pride that you will never do that one thing that you said you would never do. And that's a principle that you stand on, whatever that is. I could say that before I got called to this church, you could say to me that, Dan, you would never root for the Reds, the Cincinnati Reds. I will never root for the Reds. But hanging in my closet right now is a Reds jersey. That is new. It was a principle about civic pride that I had for the city of Pittsburgh. It was a principle that I thought would be chief among my thinking and the way that I would live my life. And that was a principle that I held until that principle was shattered. We all have principles that we have. And some of those principles that I want us to understand need to be let go of. Some of those principles that we have are ruling our lives in ways that I think we need to let go of. We need to seek flourishing by letting go of some of these principles that are not of God, that are not of Scripture, that are not meant for human care or concern. Some people will put as a premium in their lives the scientific method. Nothing wrong with that. We all benefit from the scientific method. If you don't believe me, I got a technological device up here that is a product of the scientific method. Not a bad thing. So don't hear me. Oh, these technical devices, or oh, the scientific method is bad. No, no, no. It is a way to understand the world around us. A way to put value and understanding out in the world. But some people will use the literary method. God could not do that because he has inspired me by this story. And if this story tells me what it is that is important in this world, and if you don't believe it, you watch any movie that talks about an underdog, that talks about anybody, you start buying into the fact that that person can achieve it. And you believe that they're going to achieve it because of the story that you hear. Right? The underdog can do it. And you start believing that they can do it, and you start rooting for them to do it. Story can motivate you. Literary process could create principles in your life. And that's good. That's a good thing. Meaning and value about the stories that you share about your family members. But where it goes wrong is whenever you, well, my mother taught me a different way. Well, I'm sorry. What it is that you were taught may be in conflict. I have some of those things. The things that I grew up with. We all didn't grow up with perfect examples and scenarios in our life. And yet we create principles around them and adhere to them because they're so rooted deep within our framework. Some will use philosophy, and this is the realm that I would go down and fall short of the glory of God with. This is where I would sin, is whenever I would see or wonder what the philosopher might say, and if they spin a good message, I might be convinced to give that credence and value and maybe create a principle around that. Now, nowhere do we see that more obviously than a self-help books. 7 principles to a highly effective human being. 41 principles of law, of power. You know, it's these things that we buy into that create principles in our lives that we adhere to. Some of that's good. Some. I'm not sitting here throwing grenades at these principles that we adhere to. What I'm doing is causing us to challenge those principles. However good some may be, I want us to always put on trial in front of a judge and jury any principle that is not rooted in Scripture. That should be our ultimate in defining authority. Actually, our ultimate in defining authority is Jesus Christ. He is our ultimate in defining authority. That's whom we give our lives to. So what I would say is this, if Jesus Christ came in this room and it was without a doubt Jesus Christ, I would say, listen to him over and above the Bible. But until that happens, until we can understand that, we are called to understand the Scriptures. We are called to understand the Word of God. That is what brings power into our understanding, into our knowledge. It creates those principles that I think God has called us to have in our lives. Amen? So let us get into that Scripture. A very familiar Scripture that we read and we understand. It's in 2 Timothy. And I don't want us to forget one major dynamic, that Timothy was a disciple of Paul. Now, get in your mind the conversation that will happen as the relationship that Paul will have with his disciple shows a level of intimacy, a level of care, a level of concern that Timothy doesn't go astray. And let us pay attention to what he says that he's supposed to do with recognition of those things. Let us read 2 Timothy 3:14 through 4, 5. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and become convinced of, because you know those for whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing in his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. Notice what he didn't say. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with aggression. He didn't say that. He didn't say with insults. He didn't say that. He said with grace. Preach the word, prepare with great patience, careful instruction. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your ministry, for I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. This is God's word for God's people. The very first verse speaks about the whole goal of what we're trying to, on some level, accomplish. He says, the things you've heard be said, you have learned it. Now, I want us to understand that in this process of discipleship, it does take us learning something. But it's not only learning, because the purpose of that learning, if you look at it, is it's to prepare you for the good works that you are called to do. So your learning isn't about just to make you smart. Your learning is about to develop you to be more holy, more prepared, more ready to follow Jesus Christ. Paul was basing his authority on his relationship. This is an important thing. He says, the things that you've heard me say, the things that you trust, the things that you can bank on me. You know me. I've talked with you for days, months, years. We have a tremendous relationship. If you trust one thing, trust me, he's saying. And the reason why he's doing that is important for us to understand in discipleship. Discipleship is not just a teacher up front in front of a blackboard. Discipleship is a relationship. It is a connection that you have with another person. Discipleship is about meeting with each other. It's about knowing them. You know somebody because you spend time with them, or you might read things about them, or you might build a relationship. See, the thing is that it's building credibility. It's building credence. Now, you don't just build a relationship with somebody just for that purpose. You're trying to love them completely. But as a part of that, you need to get to know them. If you want to actually care for somebody, don't just say, hey, how's your day? And then walk away. Get to know them. If you wonder about what's going on in their life, don't just wonder, go and do. Go and get to know them, because that's how you build the credence. We wonder. We wonder about Billy Graham. We consider Billy Graham in our thinking. Billy Graham was a great evangelist. And this is what it seems like he's saying, right? Be an evangelist, say the message, and the message will go out and people will come. And they'll sing a song, and when they're singing the song, everyone will bow at the altar, which, by the way, our church does not have an altar, so don't say the altar word. When we understand that they come forward to the front, and they bow and submit to Jesus, Billy Graham was being an evangelist in that space, and he was being a great one. Don't get me wrong, but what I want us to understand about Billy Graham was that people came far and wide because they heard about Billy Graham. The credence and the credibility that this man had was not because they said, hey, you know, there's this guy named Billy Graham, let's go hear him speak. No, they said more than that. They said, this man has spoken the truth. And you need to know about this guy. You need to hear about him. And so people would come to Billy Graham's message just because they trusted what they heard from their friends. What I'm telling you is that if that person was Bill Smith, no one would come and hear that guy. Not because Bill Smith doesn't have anything to say. As a matter of fact, he might have a lot to say. We don't know Bill Smith, and that's the problem. We don't know Bill Smith. The way that we build credibility and credence with one another and with the world out there is getting to know them by being with them, by trusting on the relationship that you have. Be yourself and go out into the world. Be the Christ-loving person that you are. And be that loving, Christ-loving person out in this world and get to know people. That's what we can understand from a part of this message already. And I want you to know that. You see, I did something bad when I was in middle school. I hope that doesn't come as a surprise to you all. I'm not going to actually tell the details of it, but it ended in an expulsion hearing in front of the school board. I hope that recognizes how bad of a deal it was. Now, I did not get expelled. My mother was freaking out. My dad was angry. I didn't seem to care. No offense to my mom and dad, that's not really what I wanted them to know. What I was really embarrassed of to have anybody know was my grandfather. I spent a lot of time with my grandfather, and there will be other sermon illustrations, I'm sure, through the years about my grandfather. His name is John Torres. And John Torres was not somebody that I wanted to have his shame. It's because I knew him. And what he said, I wanted to live into. This is what we have with relationships. Yes, my mother and father, I didn't want them to know that I did anything wrong, but I was a lot more comfortable with them knowing I did something wrong than my grandfather. My grandfather, I did not want to have him go, shh. I didn't want that. That's the beauty of what we have in Jesus Christ. You see, if you fast forward, there's verses 3, 4, and 5. For time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all your duties of your ministry. This takes preparation. I didn't want my grandfather to know any of this because I knew him. But I also wanted to do right. I wanted to do good. I wanted to know and understand. And one of the things that I would say beyond my own grandfather is to understand that I want to do right by Jesus. And what I think Paul is talking about these bad theologies, about these things that scratch ears. And we could talk about this until we're blue in the face. And maybe we should. Maybe that is an important topic to discuss. But what I will say is one of the major things is about human self-centeredness. What we can understand about Jesus is what Paul is saying. I am being poured out like a drink offering. I am giving myself over to Jesus Christ. I'm giving up my life. And these folks are coming up with reasons to not believe. These folks are coming up and making their own interests true. They're using exterior principles. Principles that they are valuing over and above the scriptures. That is what Paul is saying. Paul is not allowing for someone to adhere to these theologies that make you feel better about yourself. Christ will make you feel better about yourself, but he also will make you feel a little bad about yourself too. That is a reality to Christ. He's trying to make you better. He's trying to restore you. Yes, your sins are forgiven. Amen. Your sins are forgiven. Now he wants you to live like it. Now he wants you to live into it. And the way to do that is to give your life to understanding his word. Know his scriptures. I hope, I cast a vision for us. I'm a new pastor. I can do this. I can speak boldly and say cast vision and make it encouraging. I want for us to be people that are able to ask each other, what are you reading in the Bible? What have you done? What have you done in your devotions? What's interesting to you in the scripture that you're currently in? And you might ask yourself, or you might think to yourself, well, gosh, I'm not reading any scripture. That's okay. He wants you to read scripture. He wants you to start engaging his word. But he wants you to engage him. And so we read the scriptures because we believe the scriptures point to him. We read the scriptures because it says that it produces righteousness. We read the scriptures because we believe that that righteousness that is produced from reading the scriptures will help us serve him better. We are reading the scriptures so that we can understand Jesus, so that we can know who he is. So I want us not to feel guilty for not reading the Bible. If you're not reading the Bible daily, it's okay. I think you should. But it's okay at this point. Because I want us to be people that grow into this relationship. And it's not about should. It's not about guilt, shame, or embarrassment. It's about you get to know this God who loves you. You get to understand him. And he gives you words to be able to do that. And we live in a society. This has not always been the case for the church. But we live in a society that is predominantly literate. And the best-selling book out there is the Bible. We have no excuse to at least engage his word regularly. I know that sounds like I'm putting a law out there and I'm making it a standard by which you're supposed to do it, but you can't read it enough in the scriptures. Don't let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night. I mean, it shows up in the Psalms. It shows up in Joshua. It shows up all over the place. Read his word, not because you're trying to earn a salvation, but because you're trying to understand your salvation. You're trying to grow in your knowledge of it. And one of the great works that you can do is to make it known. That is it. Who here has ate something delicious? If that isn't everybody here, Shane, that feels bad. Let's go get you something delicious to eat. When you eat something delicious, and you see that somebody else could also eat that same thing, like say if you go to a buffet, or you're at your family member's house, and you see they aren't trying the dish that you're trying, don't you say, I don't think I'm speaking out of turn, don't you say, you should really try the pumpkin pie. It is really good. You do that because you like that person. You do that because you like the pie and you want them to experience the goodness of that pie. That's why you do that. That's what you're doing with Jesus. You like Jesus enough that you want your friends and family. Now, that sounds like I'm saying, oh, now you have to make a mission out of your friends and family. Look, what Paul is saying here is to be an evangelist means that you're going to share the hope that you have. Do that in a way that makes the most sense to what God has called you to do. If you're not prepared to give all the proofs of why the Bible's the Word of God and why Jesus is, that's not something you have to do. But you have a hope, and you can describe it. And a way to be able to understand it is by reading His Word. The hope we have is in Jesus Christ. And that hope is talked about in His Word. Love Him by loving that Word. That's good news. He's given us a message. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, you've given us an act that marks us as a disciple. Help us to be that disciple. It's in your Son's holy name. Amen. Let us stand and sing. Thank you.
You don't have to read the whole book in a day, but verse a day. Produce fruit
in your life. I promise. I've seen it too much for it to not be true. So let us walk around and ask each other, what are you reading in the scriptures? As a way to encourage. Let me bless you. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the fellowship and the power of the Holy Spirit, and the love of God the Father be with you always, now unto ages of ages. Go in peace.